Hello and welcome to the Cafe Cast, and today we've got a special topic that I know everybody is just so excited to talk about. Bringing joy to millions, it's the latest Equestria Girls movie. Yeah, that's what I thought. Okay.
That was much rejoicing.
Yeah. Back to pretty much the regular cast this time, including...
Fast Analysis! Hey, I'm back! Oh, also, I hate this movie, so it's going to be so much fun to bash analysis. Yeah, bash analysis. Oh, that's basically what I'm going to be tonight.
Okay, but we also have...
Hey, everybody, I'm Calliope.
Yes, she is.
Hello. Hey guys, it's Unova Brownie speaking. How you all doing?
They all just said, like, in unison, good.
Hi, Unova.
And that brings us to...
Hello everybody, I am Cadet Redshirt, reporting for review. Yay.
Okay, so... Why don't we go around then, start with thoughts in a nutshell on this movie, because, yeah, I know there's just so much to talk about.
So, I guess I honestly don't have a whole lot to say about this movie. It's kind of the most meh of all the Equestria Girls movies to date so far. There wasn't anything in there that I especially hated, but there wasn't anything in there that especially caught me and said, ooh, yeah, I really love that either. So, you know, I think, like, comparing it to the first movie had some really low points, but it also had some pretty high points, and this just was so middle of the road, it didn't have any either really lows or really highs. So I don't have a whole lot to say about it.
It's about the impression I've been hearing so far, yeah.
You're more fortunate than I am. I had a lot of lows. A lot of lows.
Yeah, so why don't you go ahead?
Let it pass out of the cage.
Uh-oh.
Okay. So, this is easily the worst Equestria Girls movie, by far. I was mostly bored and unimmersed in this movie because of a couple things. One, they had to focus that much on copy Twilight, a copy character. And if any of you know who I am, I hate copy characters. I do not think they are good. I think that... Oh, hey, Crimson.
Last minute appearance of Crimson Glow.
First, we're talking about the new Equestria Girls movie, and we just unleashed Past's wrath.
I thought that we were starting at 6.
Time zone mountain. Differences are fun.
Ba-dun-dun.
Yes, aren't they? Now let me get my motherfucking...
I think we cut you off, so...
Yeah, we've got plenty of time, Crimson.
Okay.
What the fuck are these things?
What?
Although I will say I agree with you that I think this is easily the weakest Equestria Girls movie because it didn't hit any of the highs that the others did, but go ahead.
So what I was getting at is that the majority of this film focused on human Twilight, more so than Equestria Girls 3, and I really bashed Equestria Girls 3 for doing that. So this movie was like, it got even worse, and the piece of it I think that made this movie I think worse than Equestria Girls 3 in this regard is that Equestria Girls 3 still had the sort of main focus towards the games that was still there. I don't really feel like that was completely shafted by the whole human Twilight stuff, whereas in this movie, I mean, we hardly get into the camping stuff at all until it's just basically a human Twilight movie. Like, the magic displays where they all happen to have magic, that happened really fast. Like, there was that whole period in the movie where one after another, they just introduced that, and it's like, the movie wound up having like no theme in its center because all it was just, oh, magic is back. Oh, what do we do? And also, the woe is me from Human Twilight. You know I love that. see, Human Twilight, again, this is sort of playing at what I've said about Starlight. Everybody has forgiven her, and she is still sort of dwelling on it. And I mean, I get it. The whole Midnight Sparkle thing is going on. I get it, but it's still annoying. And still, you know, I would have much rather they not done that. So there was that, and then I guess. So beyond the fact that the focus was basically lost on Human Twilight, that we didn't really get a main focus, I'd also say that this movie kind of worsened the whole, like, they're special and they're not. Like, for some reason, only they get the magic from their pony counterpart. I think it would have been a lot.
I found that weird too.
Yeah,
that was a little weird. Like, why isn't everyone going crazy?
Yeah, exactly. Why isn't
it
everyone going?
It would have been awesome, kind of like in the "Do Princesses Dream of Magic Sheet." That would have been cool.
In this camp, they all have superpowers.
Yeah,
that would have been the ultimate summer getaway right there.
Oh yeah,
I think based on. I'm not sure, but I think it's supposed to be that they're the only ones who get magic because they're the only ones who were exposed to the element of magic in the first movie.
Mm. Bullshit.
I mean, Rainbow Rocks did do a good job keeping the focus on that, and I mean, Friendship Games at least tied it back, like, okay, this is just the magic continuing to develop. This one, I mean, it seemed like it was just more
bullshit.
Concerned in making the parallel work.
I would say that explanation makes sense, but I'm kind of along with Crimson here. I just wouldn't do that. Like, you don't need to do that. You can do it where, like, the magic is given to everybody. Like, that was a choice I feel they made, and I really don't agree with them for making it. I also
kind of would have served it better to say that, look, they can all be friends. They can all share in the magic. I'm just saying, I think that's probably the reasoning they use.
Magic. Gotta feel like you're crawling in love.
So first they get the magic, and then they have to go superhero style. Like, really? Really? Sail it like. Why did you... Oh, that was so fucking annoying. Oh, Also, by the way, I didn't notice this when I first watched it, or when I watched it the second time. I may have not been looking that hard at the picture of Human Twilight. Turns out that Human Twilight has pony ears and wings.
You didn't hear that?
She flew up in there, she flies
and she's like over everything, so yeah, that I also found very odd, because now it's kind of bringing up this sort of new question, like, hey, do you get powers, or do you get the pony version of your yeah. pony thing at the time? Or, you know, I did talk to Second about this in the mod chat of, like, this different theory, and it sounds stupid, and I probably shouldn't have brought it up. It's actually
crazy. I mean, that's what I'd like to hope it is, that, you know, it's just a case of they get the you know, whatever it is of their pony couch. But it still is stupid. It's still completely dumb.
Did anybody else notice that Applejack is the only one with the Earth Pony powers?
Yes.
Oh, I do have,
Sorry, I do have to say, I kind of, one thing that I did enjoy in the movie, they gave all of the, like, really basic superhero powers, like super strength, super speed.
It's like your Hawkeye.
Talking to animals, being an empath, telekinesis, and I love that they all the other six got these really basic superhero powers, and Pinkie Pie got the power to transform sugar into fireworks.
She became Gambit, and it was great! Like, I get party cannon, but she doesn't have that ability. If anything, her ability should be to teleport.
She made the little fireworks with the sprinkles, and then in the stinger at the end, she made bigger explosions with marshmallows. So I think the larger quantity of sugar she has, the bigger an explosion she can make.
She can never bake again.
There's a curse. She can't survive if she doesn't throw it.
It would have been really bad if the nails actually exploded.
Unless they turn into confetti like they did in the end.
Yeah. So now I believe I can actually talk about the stuff I liked. Because there was...
Oh, there's stuff that you liked?
Yes, there was stuff I liked, which is maybe a surprise to some people.
I thought you were just filled with hatred and quibble pants.
Quibble pants. He's filled with quibble pants. This is not...
I'm mostly quibble, like 90%. So, I actually felt this film did a better job of making Sunset interesting over EQG3. EQG3, I felt like, you know, the conflict they gave her was to some extent a repeat, because in Equestria Girls 2, they kind of brought up the whole thing about the pony ears. Granted, they didn't go into detail about it, but it still felt like it was a little bit too close to the previous movie for me. But with this one, you know, like, eventually, like, I like what they did here. The whole Flash stunted thing, I kind of approve of that.
I didn't want it to happen. The way that it happened for me was just kind of like out of nowhere. It's like, oh, I've been looking at you from afar, and you've changed. You want to be friends and slowly get together?
Well, since Flash is so undefined, I can almost kind of buy that when Sunset is...
at least he didn't say Starlight. At least he didn't say Starlight.
That's true. Maybe that mistake. Well, I'm glad her name is not Sunset, or that could have been really bad. But, anyway. Since Flash is so undefined, I could buy that, once Sunset has come out of her shell a little bit, has, like, kind of found herself that, post that he could be the right guy for her, but I mean...
I kind of agree. I think that he's rather undefined. I think it got better with G3, where, like, his awkwardness really started coming out. But I would actually argue... Him trying to get back in with Sunset shows how much this guy is desperate to have a fucking...
He's desperate to have some horse plot.
No, well, he's just desperate to have some plot, I think. I mean...
Oh, gosh.
Well, technically, she's still a horse, dude.
Yeah, she is.
No, she is, but, like, he was trying to get in with the human Twilight until he's like, oh, yeah, maybe I should stop doing that.
I actually kind of appreciate that he could understand and respect that although she looked just the same, she wasn't the same person.
Yeah, that. I mean, if he couldn't do that, then he was simply like an ape. He was an idiot beyond belief. But I liked it. I thought it was a nice piece. I also, as much as I didn't like the fact that they got powers, I loved that Sunset got the power to basically mind read. That was awesome. Let's see. So there was that. I generally liked, I felt like Sunset's whole approach to the magic made sense. I liked the fact that they gave her a song, though granted I don't like
all
that.
All hail the waifu!
I didn't like that they gave my hated human Twilight the first song, another solo song, like she already got one in the third movie. Now she got one here. Anyway, but continuing the positive, I'm getting off track. So I guess then also I'd say that I did kind of like Timber and Gloriosa. Granted, I have a bias towards new characters, especially when I'm being shown copy characters at the same time. And, you know, they were cool. They were cool. I mean, like, they were different. I liked the whole kind of struggle that Gloriosa had. I thought that was kind of cool. I didn't think that the twist was much of a twist. I kind of saw that coming, seeing as
internal screaming.
Also, the fact that she had that weird exchange with Filthy Rich.
I did kind of like how they twisted it a little bit, but it wasn't much of one. It was kind of like the twist with Spit. From Rarity Investigates, where we all know who it is, but it was just like kind of nice little twist to try to have. It was nice. It was cute.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I gotta step away for just a minute. I'll be right back.
And to be honest, that felt like a better motivation than Gloriosa, really. Like, what if he really was trying to do these at the same time? And try to sell it off to Filthy Rich while she's trying to save it. He's trying to close it down, not because of camp, but more so for her benefit to get her out of the crazy.
Yeah. I kind of felt like Sunset was being a little harsh on the guy. I mean, I didn't... All you saw was basically the little dust from his pocket and him telling the story. That's the only bit.
That he was at every event.
He was at every event. So, I mean, but I didn't really see the motivation there. When I was watching him fight with his sister, I just like to have sisterly. They have tension. In fact, later after the reveal was given, it actually makes a lot of sense why he was kind of, you know, why he was a little bit against them doing the yearly thing, because it might have been the last camp session, and as he said, he didn't want them putting that much time in their, you know, camp into something that would ultimately be taken down. So, I mean, I thought it worked. I thought it was generally good character. I think. Also, I gotta say, him with an axe. He loves that axe.
Oh yeah. Did anybody else think he was actually going to axe his sister?
Axe in a summer camp. Where do you think that leads?
After that, like, I didn't mind the romance between him and human Twilight. I mean, I guess I have a large tolerance for shipping when they do it in these movies. I really don't seem to care.
The ship will be shipped and they will sail ashore.
Okay, now I remember what I was going to get at, though. So, with the romance thing, I mean, I still hate human Twilight. I still would rather they not do something like that. But I liked it for what they did for him. Whereas for the whole camp event, I think that in theory the idea worked, but I think that in practice it was just too large a concept to tackle, because by doing the thing where like the camp is kind of on its last rungs. And having Gloriosa fix it, Hey, Calliope. It kind of that's sort of like the force that undermined a lot of the main focus, because you couldn't really have them doing much of these camp events because apparently the camp was, in that poor shape. You know, the fishing, the lake, the river had to be, water had to be put back in the river. There was no wind for sailing, though granted that's not really the end of the world.
That's what you go canoeing.
So I just kind of felt like there was a lot going on. I think that they could have demonstrated the maybe poor condition of the camp in a different way. Maybe they could have had it have to do with like the camp buildings instead of the camp environment. I think that would have been kind of nice. And then I guess the last thing I like is I like this idea that magic is gradually getting, you know, put more so into this world. I think I don't like how it's being implemented, but the simple idea of magic being, you know, inserted into this world, I dig it. I dig it. It's kind of cool, you know?
I dig it.
I mean, I will say for Human Twilight, while she is one of the points on the table there, I mean, like, I will say for as much as they're kind of trying to rotate out our Twilight, Human Twilight does kind of have, or did kind of have at least, her own character, like the, I guess the version of this person who not only is not anyone special, not only didn't, like, discover the magic of friendship and become and come to like see it as this like her favorite force or whatnot, like this Twilight didn't even get Celestia taking her on board or telling her she was anything special. Like she's
kinda... I would say that she was a restart Twilight. She was basically at the same position that our Twilight started at.
Not even that, because like I said, she didn't have. Well, I mean, she had Cadence as a friend. She had what Twilight had before Celestia took her on board. But I mean, basically nobody's told her that she's anyone special or like put her in charge of anything until the friendship games. But I mean,
anything that, yeah, can I add to that?
What?
Can I add to that?
So
now, yes, through that she didn't have like Celestia or Luna or any of like the more positive figures that Pony Twilight had. She did have someone saying that she had the principal of that school saying that she was special, that her abilities are unique.
Yeah, but it wasn't shown.
But it wasn't shown in a way that was positive or reassuring. Instead of it being something to improve on and to have friends in the meantime, it was more like something you have this ability, but you're really only good for that ability. Mm-hmm. So
it's like everything this Twilight had gotten, she kind of just got herself.
Like, I feel like though these differences that you're bringing up, they're all relational. They all have to do with who is around her. They don't actually have to do with.
Well, Twilight is a very relation oriented person.
No,
character in the Ponyverse. I can't believe I actually said that. I said that.
Yeah, you said
that.
Shut up. In the pony world, I really didn't think I would say that 5 years from now. But in the pony world, Twilight is still a very relationship-oriented person. Like,
no, she,
for example, she, in the beginning, she did have friends, but most of her relationships that she centered herself around were around Books, Spike, and Celestia, with the occasional Cadence or Shining Armor. But we see that Shining Armor and Cadence weren't around, and growing up, she had maybe a handful of friends, but most of her relationships were in the Books and Spike. But then fast forward to Ponyville. Ponyville, she starts gaining new friends. These new friends start changing her, and she changes along with the bride.
She's a very relationship-oriented person.
No, but
so it makes sense that this Twilight would do that.
No, but see, that's not that wasn't my point. My point was, I didn't really get to finish it, was you guys are talking about her relationships with us. You're not necessarily talking about how this human Twilight acts different than regular Twilight.
Mm-hmm. I think that what Prince was touching upon there is that a lot of times what defines people just as much as like their inherent traits is who they become, who life shapes them up to be. And I mean, I do think that at least could have been interesting if they'd, if this Twilight's purpose in the franchise was like how she was different and how, her influences led her in other directions.
If you show these relational elements massively affecting her, then it can be significantly different. However, there wasn't much of that shown in the third movie. Not much at all. I mean, there was subtle differences in terms of how she acted, and you know, like that. For a copy character, that is not the formula you need to use. For a copy character, the formula you need to use is you need to find a very clear, explicit difference between them, because otherwise, you know, for the most part, the character is just a copy of, you know, in this case, Pilot Twilight with the changes that you mentioned. What?
There is one major difference.
What? There is
one major difference between Twilight and between Twilight from Pony from our Pony world and from the human Twilight. You know what? I'm just going to call her Psy Twi. The marketing says she's Psy Twi. Fuck it.
Why not?
Anyway, what is the major difference?
Yeah, what's the major difference?
The major difference is while Twilight from the Ponyverse does try to please one particular person, and that's Celestia in the beginning, and we're going at ground zero here. I'm going ground zero, Twilight, she's trying to please Celestia, try to show her how good she is. She understands that she can only do so much.
Yeah.
Twilight from the human world wants to please everyone. She wants to make sure that she herself is able to fit into this mold that they have put her up to.
I mean, at the same time, and it seemed kind of self-motivated, I would have said, just like how, yeah, she wanted to learn for its own sake, just because she didn't really have anything else to dedicate herself to, so it's like, yeah, why not do as much of what she's good at as she can?
But for the most part, everything when it comes to her character, she's a people pleaser in the way that she's still an introvert, but she's still people pleaser in everyone else's approval. While Twilight from our world understands that she's not going to get everyone's approval, and she kind of just accepted that.
You actually convinced me. Yeah. No, that is a difference, I think, between human Twilight, I'm not calling her Psy Twi. And
why not? It's Psy Twi!
Because she's a copy, and I will always acknowledge that when I define her.
Yeah.
Why don't you say copy Twi?
Well, I was going to mention another difference between them, which I think ties into yours.
Okay.
That one of the defining characteristics of Pony Twilight is that despite her power and her prestige, she has always been a fairly humble character. You know, she's always been insistent that just because she's a princess, she's not better than anyone else. Just because she has more magical ability, that doesn't make her superior. So she's always been defined very strongly by her humility. But even so, Pony Twilight has also had good self-esteem and a good sense of what she is good at, what her own capabilities are. And it balances out it pretty well. I think with human Twilight, she shares the humility, but she doesn't have the confidence or the sense of what her own strengths are, so it becomes debilitating rather than balancing.
And yeah, I think that I would agree with that. But all that said, I think that it's kind of been drowned out by the franchise's need to have a Twilight in this group to market with the rest of them, because, I mean, I think that, well, actually, you see what Josh Haber's original idea for Equestria Girls 3 was. It seemed to be a lot less worried about Twilight, and more with she didn't even join the main six at the end. She went back to the other school and was going to make her way there.
I think that would have been stronger.
Yeah, I think that would have been a great direction.
And then have Sunset Shimmer go back to Equestria. That would have been such a great episode in the show. Oh, my God. Have Starlight and Sunset Shimmer meet up and be like, hey, what's up?
Yeah. See, I mean, I could have, like, gone for Starlight.
I've been trying to get in here for a bit. That cutscene that they almost did would have been so much better, I think. It would have been so much better.
Yeah.
Like, cannot overstate that. Earlier I wanted to mention on the topic with the, you know, differences between Twi and human Twi, or copy Twi, that's better. I'll grant you that those are differences, and I think that when you really push me on it, that the issue I have is that they are too subtle a difference. I feel like when you have a copy character, you really, really have to try to make it very clear how they differ, because just as an audience member, seeing those two, I'm almost predisposed to see this character as being the same as the other one. Like they are that similar, and you have to do something to draw them apart. And on the topic that you were just mentioning, oh, come on, no, it's the same color palette, it's the same name. Yeah. No.
I mean, granted, there are the other friends, too, but I think they kind of want you to see them as the same characters.
Yeah.
I mean, their differences are pretty subtle, too, if you think about it.
Well, they do, I guess, like Fluttershy still being a little shyer are there, but you're basically supposed to see them as the same characters.
The difference between the other main six copies and the main six is also very subtle, but the thing is that the other main six have not been given anything, like not a single one of them has been given the focus that the human Twilight has been given. None of them. So their copiness has in some sense not been like really shouted over the rooftops, whereas copy Twilight's has. And what I was going to say is that, so you were mentioning earlier, second, that that Hasbro really wants to make it seem as though these characters are the same. See, I would argue that because of how Hasbro and DHX maybe are going at this, they are actually making perhaps the worst alternate universe characters imaginable, because they're trying to focus on the similarities, whereas I bet you, most people who actually write stuff like this in fan fictions or whatnot usually are trying to they're usually trying to show the differences between the human, you know, the copies and the non-copies. They are trying to do that.
He
said it was what they wanted to do. He didn't say it was a good decision.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, I think Equestria Girls, like, reason to exist to keep building as a franchise, I think, would be to have its own flavor and show us some of the differences here, like how this translates into the main six is just, like, secretly special characters in a high school world where, I mean, a lot of people end up blending together.
And because they went with the decision at the end of EQG3 to have her join in with the rest of them, they chose at that point to steer away from that direction, and EQG4 is just the, you know, that's the outcome. The outcome is, we're copies! That's it.
Like, I mean, wasn't bothered by their decisions they made in, well, at least not the plot itself of... Equestria Girls 3. I mean, I think that Twilight did serve her own purposes there. I think here you can kind of see them trying to work her into being the same character, like how they have her become Alicorn Twilight at the end, and just...
Oh, yeah.
How
That's weird.
You actually just reminded me of another point. In EQG 2, Sunset and Twilight were in the center, and, you know, they were kind of, like, they were the center ones. They were the focal point of the group. In this movie, in EQG 4, copy Twilight, yeah, I'm actually using it without having to repeat myself. Copy Twilight is in the center.
Yeah, it's kind of the same. They're trying to do the same dynamic there.
And Sunset is in the back. So by just some comparative, you know, just by comparing them, it seems that apparently Human Twilight is more important than Twilight and Sunset combined. That's how important she is, because she's got to take the center when previously Twilight didn't even hog the center from Sunset. They're both in the center. So why are you having it that she's like this like, oh, she's like the group leader or like the group, the big one. Like, I don't get it. Why? Why do that?
Which, and granted, I didn't think it was quite that extreme, because they did give Sunset a role in the, well, a pretty big role here, and they had Sidetwy kind of need
wasn't
her,
big
but
enough.
But
wasn't
yeah,
big
well,
enough.
I think that, well, I would just argue that even making them equal is a little too big, because Human Twilight hasn't really earned that yet.
Oh yeah. Thank you. Yeah, put her in the rungs. Don't. Yeah.
Anyway. Unova, I think it was your turn.
Alrighty then, for me, my thoughts about the movie were, I honestly feel like it's kind of either second, but more likely third place for me. Like, clearly above the first movie, because honestly...
Duh.
Yeah, it is.
Duh. It's first movie is still second place, in my opinion, beating EQG3 and EQG4, but go on.
That's all because right. of Waifu.
It's more than that.
But that helps a lot of it.
But like for this movie, like when I first watched it, one of the most negative things I would have to say, something that honestly insulted me as like the concept I wanted to bring out in like my own reviews or like in my own character or even the whole concept in general, was Twilight's solo song. Midnight in Me. My goodness, how could you screw up a duality song?
I mean...
Wait, it's a duality song?
Like a duality between like the innocent Twilight and this Midnight Sparkle entity that she's
That's
hyping.
That's not
up.
Really a duality. Usually duality songs have to do with, have both characters singing. Kind of like in Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde.
Okay. Maybe that's not what I meant. Like, what I was trying to say was
a
like
coming of age song,
no,
inside of me song.
Yeah, dealing with like the evil devil inside of me. Yes, dealing with the evil devil. It's like they made
the stereotype that most red and black OCs have to go through.
Yeah, and it's honestly quite uninteresting. Even though the lyrics had promise, when I first heard sneak peeks of it, I was like, oh, this is gonna be a great first song. After hearing the entire one, it's like Twilight's delivery in singing, and not just here, but also in the third movie. Probably like the entirety of the Equestria Girls series. Whenever Twilight sings by herself, it always plops. It always flops. I don't know why.
Is it potentially because she's a copy Twilight?
No. I'm including normal Twilight from the first movie.
Oh.
Normal Twilight's first song in that movie kind of drove me up the wall, just like...
Normal Twilight's song. What was Normal Twilight's song?
This world is so different A water fountain. Isn't that so strange?
I liked it. Thank you very much.
I'm not trying to say that like it's like a universally hated song. It's okay for you to like it, Pasa.
I know.
Yeah.
It sounded a lot like Belle from Beauty and the Beast, like a reverse Belle from Beauty and the Beast song.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Well, on the topic of the songs, with every other Equestrian Girls movie, all the first three, afterwards, I found myself humming the songs.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there was at least one song in each movie, and generally more than one, that I just found myself humming a little bit in the next couple of days. And now I'm sitting here desperately trying to remember how any of the songs in this movie went.
I couldn't remember how any of them went the minute I finished watching the movie.
I did. I unfortunately did. You know why?
Why?
The best song in that fucking movie, the best song was the villain song.
Agree.
It always is the villain songs because the villain songs are awesome, and I wish Sunset Shimmer got one.
Yeah. I mean, it was kind of cool to look at, but even that didn't have any like memorable lines. I mean, it's something about how nature is good, and so I'm going to kidnap you with it.
I honestly remember how creepy that song was.
I mean, I get that there was like a creep factor. I remember the gist of what it was about. I don't remember any of the lines.
The songs in this movie were just forgettable in a way that none of the previous movies have been. I mean, they've all had songs that were better or worse, and especially the first movie had some songs that weren't all that good at all. But I just don't remember a thing about any of the songs in this movie.
Well, see, I think there was one
that was almost a country song.
I think I remembered most of the song, but that's because the second one was Copy Twilight, the third one was Sunset. And then the villain song, which made me remember it so much, is it had the tone, the angry tone, which I actually was feeling by the time that it got to that song.
I won't say that all of the songs were terrible, but I thought they were all just kind of bland.
It was really bad, too, because I was trying to remember the bad song, and I got Heartswarming Tale, the Luna one. I was singing that tune, and I'm like, that's not even the song that's the one that...
They were kind of similar.
I actually don't remember that song at all. I don't remember that song at all.
I remember, like, the vague tune of it, like, now the future is a cold nightmare, and that's... That keeps vaguely how this song goes as well.
The tune, the melody, the way the melody's carried.
They're equally forgettable. How about that?
I will say that the songs are still not as good as in EQG2 with Rainbow Rocks. Like, but to be fair, the point of the songs weren't so in this particular one weren't so much to be a device used throughout, because there's really only three character songs which you're supposed to remember the most, and those were supposed to be like to really develop the characters in general, or to just improve their moods. In places like Rainbow Rocks, it was used as a tool, and that's why you remember a lot of the songs.
I thought that a lot of the songs were supposed to be kind of their own point, just like they... I mean, it was about a band competition, so I think they took time to just, like, make the songs in and of themselves... The purpose of the scene, just like, this is the band putting their entry out there. You're supposed to get into how good or bad each entry was. And with that said, actually, I thought that's where Rainbow Rocks might have suffered for some of the songs, because if you're going to make them in and of themselves the point, you'd better do a little better than Shake Your Tail.
Shake Your Tail, because you're here to have a party.
I thought they kind of made too many of them sound the same. Like, I felt like I did not need to hear Trixie's song twice. Actually, I think their very last song the Rain Booms played, their big song to beat the Dazzlings, was ironically, other than Shake Your Tail, maybe their worst one.
I think on some levels, EQG3 was able to hit the same high in terms of music. I did think a Cathalon, you know, the one where it was sort of like group chants. I did think that one was, you know, like
that was motivating. Song.
Yeah, I really liked all the songs in Equestria Girls 3. I thought pretty much all of them were solid.
I don't remember any of them.
I mean, the cell block. I remember, what? And you know, at the end of the day, it is we who survive. Rainbow Dash was born to do triumph.
There was like a really fun taunt in the middle of it, too, where it's like, can't or not a lot. And I was like, damn, you guys, come on.
I like it.
Just like saying bad things to each other in the middle of that song.
Like, that was catchy. I don't know if I went for the Cell Block Tango one as much.
Yeah, that song was way too much like the Cell Block Tango. I'm sorry.
Speaking of memorable lines, do you all remember the "They have come into our domain"?
Oh my god, that was such a weird song because it, or that particular part was a little weird for me because it's like, our domain?
Yeah.
Are we talking about the voices in your head?
I thought it was like really, really cool. Like, it was so like dark. I loved it.
Yeah. I especially loved just Gloriosa's design when she turns into Gaia Everfree. Mm-hmm. Like, what the fuck? You were able to make that character look so completely different from her original design, and yet I can still identify that character as the character from before. Like, if you notice in her design, they actually took the color scheme of her clothes and her hair, and they put it on her dress.
Mm.
They also only slightly darkened the skin tone, and they kept her freckles, which I thought was an interesting choice, considering the fact that most of the other characters don't have freckles. Is that just me? Like, when it comes to that, like,
I like none of the other characters have
freckles. Yeah. Like, if you notice, like, if you look from one character to the other, they type of color differences. They kept the bushy eyebrows, which I really liked.
Although, I did think, like, the main six, their superhero transformations, while still better than the horrible Rainbow Power Forms, I think they might be at risk of becoming a little over-designed.
These are, like, the worst pony forms that they've had so far.
Yeah, it's like, why are they crystallized? I mean, I get it. You know, they had the crystal cave, but why are...
It's because Hasbro needs to push a line of crystal-themed merchandise.
I know I'm kind of come off incredibly biased here, but I have to say, Sunset's design was awesome. It was like, God,
I think that Sunset's and Rarity's designs were the best done. But overall, I thought all the pony designs for the characters seemed a little too Ever After High.
Yeah, I think you're right.
They looked way too much like the Ever After High during the dragon competition.
And they looked way too much like, just throw more sparkles on the design. Throw more sparkles on the design.
More sparkle glittery things!
Mm-hmm. Unova, should we transfer back to you?
Anything else to add?
Thanks. Okay, continuing on, what I thought about the romance for this movie. I thought it was okay. I thought it was actually good because, like, how should I put it? It felt very natural for Sideswipe to actually go for Timber, honestly. And then when the topic of Flash Century was brought up with Sunset, I didn't actually react with anger. I actually felt like, aw, I might actually see something. I might actually think you're probably more deserving of Sunset than you ever had a chance with Twilight, because my God. Sunset was there longer, so she could have acclimated. It makes more sense for me in my head because
Your ships, bro?
No, it's like I'm not like that much of a shipper. I just honestly don't like it when it doesn't make sense when a different species just all of a sudden becomes like a different body and then falls in love with the first breathing opposite gender. The first breathing member of the opposite gender.
I like it when a character that is in the fandom known as Brad, aka my name, is shipped in the movie with my waifu.
You are biased
as fuck. Well, I guess it's hard to argue with that.
Well, I could buy that Flash would be interested in Twilight because she looks like a human, and for all he knows, through most of the first movie, she is human. I don't see how she would be attracted to him because she would be attracted to ponies.
Well, no. In the defense of this movie, actually, it would make a lot of sense for, like, Sunset. Like, she decided to, like, stay in the human world, essentially. So I honestly think it might open the path for an actual relationship with another human, and it won't feel forced.
I can accept that. I'm talking about Twilight in the first movie.
There's no reason why
she should be attracted to a person.
Okay, I get one. If movies like Avatar can make these strange alien creatures, at least to a lot of people, look attractive, it's plausible. And two, if a lot of bronies can be attracted to these ponies...
Oh, boom! 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 Yeah, I agree.
Asteroids have just been dropped down from the heavens.
Twilight would get along better with the bronies than she realizes.
Oh.
Probably not, but that aside.
I'm sorry that I'm bagging on you about this.
But carry on, you know.
Bag on everybody.
Alrighty then. Continuing on. I mean, for the superpower segments, I honestly felt like it was honestly one of the best qualities of like the movie, because one, it doesn't feel like Elements of Harmony, more as it actually feels like even though these characters hardly have much characterization to them, the fact that they can be a bit more of an active force than say the actual ponies, it's really refreshing and honestly something I'm glad to see, because all this time we keep on seeing more and more of like, let's move away from the Element of Harmony and not like go for like something else that can give people like actual abilities to like combat evil, really just like their own natural abilities in the equestrian world, but giving like the Humane Seven like these abilities, it kind of makes them more functional while not being deep.
I get you. I'd agree that it definitely makes them more capable of, you know, fending off evil crap.
not just crap.
That's the next movie.
Yeah. Watch out.
They fight Muk from Pokemon. Or the Smooze, or I don't know.
No, come on!
Oh god, the Smooze! Can Muk we make that the like next movie, this? Just them versus the Smooze?
Yeah, watch the next movie be all about like pollution and Smooze is like a dust cloud.
If the next movie has another girl get overpowered with a lust for magic and turn into a demon, I'm done. When we have the four movies so far, that's been the conflict.
Well, I can't decide if that or bringing in Filthy Rich to do the most typical plot ever about trying to buy out the special place in question. I don't know which is worse.
All except EQG2. EQG2 did not have that.
Exactly. That's what I said.
Well, technically, the Dazzlings and their demons.
Hey, they're from another world. They're from another world.
Arguable. So was Sunset. It's still arguable.
Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah, EQG1 and EQG2. Thanks, Second.
And away from Second.
Do you have anything else?
No. I don't have anything else to say. And I think that it's Cadet's turn, followed by Crimson, since he was the last to come in.
Cadet has a lot to say here. Calliope, did you already say? Yeah, I basically start off by just saying
that I don't have a whole lot to say about this movie. I think it's the weakest in the series, but I found it very meh and forgettable overall.
But Cadet's turn.
Okay. Let me get out my notes here.
You're a nerd.
Yes, I wrote notes. I'm a nerd. I'm sorry. Okay, so I started off by talking about the animation and what I thought about it. I loved the facial expressions. I'm one of those people that looks at like the art and the backgrounds and things that they do with that. So they had a lot of facial expressions that I didn't expect them to go for. They did a lot more with the eyes, which is what you're supposed to be drawn to because they're so big on these characters. They had a lot of like really nice hair bounces that followed the physics correctly.
The animation does seem to get better in each movie that they do.
Yeah, and it really showed in this one. They had a lot more angles than they normally do too. We even had one watching them walk towards us, and I was like, whoa, what is going on? Everyone had pants except for Fluttershy. She still had like a jeans skirt, and I was like, oh, okay. There were a lot of one of the things that I caught last when we first watched the movie, I caught it the last second, was Celestia and Luna's designs for how they had their stuff. Celestia had like a friggin' sash of all these camp badges, like a total Girl Scout, and then Luna had like two on her shirt. It was so funny.
Imagine what they were like when they were younger.
That's what I was thinking. I'm like, that's the perfect thing to see, just to get an idea of how they were at camp. Like it summarizes it without actually having to tell us anything. It was so great.
I don't want to interrupt you, but you just reminded me of something. When you'd mentioned the shot where they're walking towards the camera, I did notice in earlier on, all the characters used the same walk cycle.
Yeah.
In the other movies, they all walked exactly the same. And if they're walking in a group, you could see they were all walking exactly the same. And then there was that shot where Rarity and Applejack were walking towards the camera, and I noticed the two of them had different walk cycles.
Yes, and it was so amazing. I was so excited about that. It was so great to see, just because I know that it takes a lot of effort to freaking do that, to change it that way. But it was so great. I liked the way that the characters were in the movie, the way that they acted together, because you could see there was that little scene where it was AJ and Rarity, like you were talking about, where you could feel their personalities coming out, and you could hear how they talk to each other and their differences, but it was, you know, character. You didn't have to, it wasn't,
did
I don't know.
Did anybody else notice the amount of Rarajack that was in there?
Yeah, I saw that. Yeah, there was a lot. There was another like subtle there's another subtle thing with like Gloriosa and Timber with their parents being dead. I don't know if anybody else caught that.
No, I caught that. That was weird.
Are
their parents dead, or are they just away?
No, I'm pretty sure they're dead because Gloriosa, when she interrupts
it's the same dynamic as when Applejack and the episode where they got their cutie marks is like mom and dad would be so proud of you.
Yeah, if they were here. Yeah, and I was like, oh, damn. But Gloriosa, there's a scene, or like though there's a subtle line they snuck in when she interrupts Timber trying to kiss Twilight. She says, I want to take him away to meet a couple of donors, and she says to him, they were good friends of mom and dad. And so I was like, does that mean that she was completely stressed out about the camp because she was thrust into the role of owner so quickly after their death? And so I was like, I wish they would have expanded on that somewhere, because that's like, again, that's mostly speculation just based on that. And then the fact that like Timber, when he's like trapped in the brambles, looking up at his sister just being overtaken by magic, he says something to the effect of, I still need my sister, and he's crying, and I was like, oh damn, what is going on? Like, it's all subtle things, and I wish they would have expanded on that just a little bit to understand what was going on.
I definitely agree that with that latter piece of, I definitely need my sister, I forget what the line was exactly.
Yeah, but you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah. That was a pretty touching scene.
Yeah.
In
regards to the songs, I was actually talking about this with someone else yesterday, where the lyrics to there are pieces of lyrics that don't make sense in context of the way the story was played out. Like in the first song, the Happy Camp guitar one. The first thing they open with is, will you be lost by time or be part of history? Will your story be told or remain a mystery? And I was like, how? But the movie, I don't...
Wait a minute, that's also referenced in the
In the bad guy song, yeah. Where she says, this camp will stay here throughout the ages, written into
the history. I thought that was just a reference to the song Throughout the Ages. Friendship Throughout the Ages.
I thought that they, like, the story went through heavy rewrites between the song completion and the actual finished product. I was like, is there a piece that we're missing? Yeah, is there a big piece we're missing somewhere about the fact that this is, like, you know, history, something to do with history? We sort of hinted at the generations thing with their great-grandparents founding the camp. But we didn't get anything else after that, and so I'm like, where's this part about history? What is going on?
To be fair, though, the fact that they actually did bring up Gaia, the differences between the original design of Gaia, like, I don't know if anybody else remembers, but she looked basically like a woman timberwolf.
Yeah, she did.
Yeah,
and her fingers were crazy too.
Where did she go? Like, because apparently Loriosa became what was basically the new, you know, spirit. So where did the first spirit go? Did she die?
Was there ever a spirit? Or was making up Timber, a story to make an explanation for the weird stuff?
Okay. Yeah. That is pretty clever. I like that.
Pasta Analysis likes.
We're almost past one hand here.
We've almost got bingo, guys.
Wow. One more, and we all get candy and Brett has to pay.
Yes.
What? No, I never agreed to this.
It's on record now. It's okay.
Just go with it.
He will not edit that out.
That's
the name
of a
really
bad Adam Sandler movie.
Oh gosh. Let me see. Where was I in my note? I agree with Calliope saying that it was sort of middle ground. In the other react that I did, I said that it came across more as a TV movie rather than a feature film like the other ones did. Because I think most of it was the songs. They weren't big, like, showy production style, and they weren't like as catchy, and so that kind of detracted from them being in the movie in general. Like, it didn't, yeah. So it felt more like a TV movie than a feature film. But I was happy that they focused on the characters, how they interact with each other, to show that. So, yeah, and that's all. That's all my notes. I can throw them away now.
Okay. So, I guess that leaves Crimson.
I actually think this is the second best movie out of them.
Wow.
Wow.
Wow. Huh.
And it might be just because I am a very visual and auditory person. And again, the animation has been beaten up, or not beaten up, it's been stepped up. Stepped up is what I mean. The animation is definitely a good part of it, in the fact that I love the designs of, like, Gloriosa, Timber, Gaia Everfree, other Gaia Everfree, the camp, just a lot of the designs are really good. I really liked the songs. I didn't really care for the beginning or the second or the ending songs, but I thought the character songs primarily were what I liked the most. Let's hear what else. Story-wise, which is what we're really focusing on, right? Story-wise, it could have done better. There, I didn't really notice little things like the history. I thought that it was just a reference to the friendship throughout the ages song. But yeah, that was interesting. You could also say that it's that the reason why those history pages type of lyrics were added in was because it was referencing how Timber kind of switched up history, like changed history a little bit for just one story. And that could have also been interesting, but I don't mind that Twilight was a big, that human Twilight was a big focus in this movie. I actually didn't mind it.
Why not? Especially because
I think one part of it is because here is a new character. We're establishing this new character because we've kind of already established and moved on from Sunset, but we haven't finished Sunset here. Even here, she's kind of in that position where Twilight was, and now she's kind of like this older sister character towards Cy Twi. And I really like that.
Copy Twi?
Copy Twi, yeah.
Yeah, Copy Twi.
Copy Twi. I really like how she's trying to mentor her in the way that Twilight from the
just the say Pony Twilight and Human Twilight.
God damn it, shut up. I really like that relationship because it mirrored how Pony Twilight talked to Sunset Shimmer when it came down to the action to Rainbow Rocks. If you notice, a lot of the tones is very nurturing and mothering, and that's a lot of what happened in Rainbow Rocks. But here, it's emphasized more than how it went through the entire thing. She now knows Cy Twi. She knows how Copy Twilight works and is now going a different direction than, say, how she was in the beginning when they first met. And I love that interaction. And even though everybody here has pretty much said most of the focus is on Twilight, Human Twilight, and Sunset Shimmer, I feel like it's still mostly about their relationship coming together. And I guess that's part I really like. Some of the designs are really cool. The songs were really fun. The visuals were really interesting. I thought it was a really cool episode, or not episode, I'm sorry. Yeah, it is a little episodic, but all the problems, though, really center around the magic in this world. For example, I thought it was kind of shooed in how they added that last bit. Hey, how did those geodes get there?
Ooh. Twilight Zone theme.
Twilight Zone.
Yeah, it was a little shoehorned in. I would have liked it better if maybe like the sirens were kind of fucking everything up and with their equestrian magic, with what little equestrian magic they had, they fucked up everything as they went along. I thought that would have been more interesting. But I do think that it's a very good way to open up different possibilities. Also, did anybody else notice how the elements of harmony are different in the human world?
Yes.
There's a stacked like, one.
There's seven, apparently. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Over there, there are not only seven, but instead of loyalty being red, it's sunset shimmers. It's sunset shimmers element that's red. Huh. So that
I don't think they're supposed to be the elements of harmony because the colors didn't match up with the elements. The colors matched up with the colors that they had for the rainbow powers,
which are pretty similar to the colors of the elements of harmony, actually.
No, because their rainbow power colors are the same as their coats. Rainbow Dash is blue, Fluttershy is yellow instead of pink, Pinkie Pie is pink instead of blue, and Rarity is white instead of purple. And in Rainbow Rocks, when they all formed the rainbow together, Sunset's color in the rainbow was red.
Yep.
Okay, I'm sorry. I got that wrong. But I still find that interesting, though. Like, I guess I just find that particular item interesting because, while, yeah, the colors are there, why is hers in particular, like, a different element? Like, what element of harmony what element in general does this world have or need that the world of freaking Equestria doesn't.
No one knows. In fact, there have been some theories as to what that seventh element is. I tend to like the idea that it's a second element of magic. But another idea. Another idea is that it's an element of empathy because Sunset Shimmer has increasingly, you know, been shown to be very empathetic.
I almost want to say it's forgiveness.
Is that an element?
Like, the seventh element is forgiveness, because if you notice in Equestria, they don't really have a whole big problem about forgiveness there.
That's true. Mm. That is very
good. Wait for all your friends to do your bidding for an afternoon, and they'll forgive you if you make a good enough apology.
Yeah, that's... Like, forgiveness is not a really big problem there. Instead, it's a really big problem, or rather, it's more of an issue, apparently, in Equestria Girls, where it's kind of more about forgiving yourself rather than forgiving others.
But I don't know if you could actually say, does Sunset really have, like, demonstrate the element of forgiveness that much? Does she?
I would say so.
I mean,
not only does she forgive Celestia for whatever she did, like, for not getting her way, in fact, she understands that. You also have her forgive herself after one movie. She has now showing someone else that she can forgive herself as well as try to guide her through that forgiveness. And then we have her empathizing, saying, "Hey, it's okay. Forgive yourself for like this. This is okay. It's okay for you to feel that way. Nobody is going to blame you." It's a lot of forgiveness to me.
I would say that your best argument, in my opinion, for this theory is that Equestria does not seem to have this friendship issue at all. That part I think I really resonate with. So, you know, good job.
Hey, it's a hell of a lot better than my fan theory. Like, freaking Second and Unova know what the fuck I'm talking about. Like, holy shit.
Yeah, your fan theory was kind of like, I didn't want to say anything because I think I would have been rude.
No, I think it's completely
How dare you have a theory on something that is not probably going to happen in the show.
Now wait, now what was the theory?
We'll talk. Well, we might talk after this recording, but it's really convoluted, and it would take way too much time.
Gotcha.
To be honest, headcanons that involve a seventh element of harmony are kind of a pet peeve of mine, because the lore in the show establishes six elements, and most of the stories and things that I've seen that bring in a seventh element end up being like total Mary Sue insert things, where it's like, I'm the seventh element of harmony, and I've gotten a really bad taste in my mouth for those theories.
I think we're all a bit of an element of harmony. Let's just.
One person
can represent the same element. Celestia and Luna wielded three elements each, and they wielded the same elements that the main six do now. So, having six elements doesn't limit the people who can be involved, because more than one person can share the same element, possibly, or.
But you can't deny the fact that friendship is way more complicated than that.
Like the six they picked in the first place were just like, they're already picking just good qualities to have in a friend. Could you potentially find other qualities that don't necessarily fall under those first six categories? Probably.
No, absolutely. Friendship is complicated. But from the beginning, the six elements... is an incredibly simplistic and, I'd argue, arbitrary setup. And to add one more doesn't necessarily fix it. It's still a very small number for friendship. Now, I agree. I liked your explanation for the seventh element of forgiveness, but ultimately I got to side with Calliope that I'm kind of with her too, and that's why I kind of prefer that she just be a second element of magic. Because
That works.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay, well, how do we fit Sunset Shimmer into the group since we technically already had those established six? She's the other element of magic.
She's like the super magic. Super magic.
Well, no, remember that she was Celestia's protege before Twilight, and Celestia was probably tapping ponies who had the potential to wield the element of magic.
Oh, dear. I'm sorry, I'm incredibly immature. I'm incredibly immature. I'm so sorry.
We already knew that, but anyway. Okay, but yeah, my feelings on the Equestria Girls movies, like, in a nutshell, from the start, just been kind of like, they're watchable. I mean, like, the first one, I mean, I was as scared as anybody that it was going to be a Disney Channel original movie knockoff. And it kind of was.
Don't knock the Disney Channel originals. I mean, we had legendary movies back in the day. I mean, remember the 13th Year?
Halloween Town.
My Clones.
Halloween Town. Xenon. Halloween Town.
What the hell did I miss in my childhood?
It's kind of degenerated, I think, into the teeny bopper formula. Just like, there are.
We just ignore everything that comes.
Hey, guys, I'm going to have to get going pretty soon, just so you know.
Okay.
All right, see ya. Quickly, second. Hurry.
All right, but the first one, in spite of all that, like, the fact that in some ways it was what we were afraid it would be, I think it did manage to convey a pretty solid arc of Twilight, kind of growing into her role as a leader. I actually thought it worked better on that front than Magical Mystery Cure, so, I mean, I was... And that's not saying a lot, but I was not unhappy to see it. It is kind of so-so as it was. Rainbow Rocks, I mean, certainly a little better. I think people were so eager to maybe erase the first one, the bad taste it left in some people's mouths, to not have that as there as a definitive image in this franchise of, High School Musical sort of thing. So I think that people might have been a little too eager to give it praise, and I think it was still kind of a very much a made for TV movie making a quick stop into theaters. I think it was pretty disjointed. I think it could have actually crashed if Sunset Shimmer's part of the plot hadn't come through as strong as it did. So, I mean, I think that it still was better of the two. I think it still had a lot, like, more fun stuff going for it. But, I mean, still not, like, a great movie. Just, like, kind of still solid enough to me. And then the third one, much the same. Although I did think that was the one that maybe could have finally hit the next level. Like, it kind of cut the cord to reality almost in a lot of ways. Just like, instead of pretending that this is a plausible high school setting, it just sort of like did whatever it wanted just to enhance the plot it was going for. Like, okay, you want this totally over the top competition between schools involving all things competitive, like, sure, go for it. And it seemed to get a lot of fun out of that. But it also, like I mentioned, the plan Josh Haber had in mind originally for it, and I think the fact that he didn't go with that sort of shows what the limits of these movies are, like, still trying to be just this marketable, like, little corner of the franchise that's still sort of made to both be something that new fans can buy and that old fans at least don't close the door on entirely. And I think that it really showed there that they held back from trying to be all they could be and not worrying about who would not understand what continuity or, yeah. So that's the only thing. Although I did think it had like the most cohesively strong story of the three. And now this one, I think it, by now, I mean, since the first movie is maybe settled into its, what's the word I'm looking for? Well,
Disney Channel animated series?
Well, I think it found its own footing as the thing. It's maybe gravitated away from that. It seems like it's a little more comfortable with like how to play all of these characters and what they do as human versions of the main six. I also think this is where it's kind of tapering off into the made-for-TV...
See, I would actually argue the opposite. I would argue that the Equestria Girls series is getting... It's becoming more of a copy of the original.
I said, yeah. Not mimicking... I didn't talk about getting farther away from the show. I was talking about getting farther away from, like, the Disney Channel original movie formula.
Oh, okay.
Because, I mean, that's cool. But, I mean, it seems like, though, here it's sort of settled into just being the sort of, like, quick and easy piece of unchallenging, made-for-DVD work that we were kind of afraid the first one would be. Like, I didn't get a strong sense of an overriding arc in this one. I didn't get the sense of like any particular character's plot coming through very strongly. So, glad you brought up before that as much as people don't like about the first one, it did sort of have high points. It did have this arc for Twilight. I mean, it is, in some ways you could argue it's the moment where Twilight rose to the challenge of being a princess, title, because you can't say queen in this world, but anyway. Magical Mystery Cure didn't really... I mean, it gave her lots of praise for what she'd already done. I don't think it really laid out much of a challenge in front of her, much character growth in front of her to get her from A to B, ultimately, where Equestria Girls kind of did. And now this movie, I mean, I will give this movie credit in that I thought the ideas were there, but I felt like it kind of needed more time than it took on them. I mean, it's 72 minutes, but I mean, okay, like Twilight's thing, worrying about becoming Midnight Sparkle, that doesn't go very far beyond what we see at first, and then it just sort of resolves itself. Like, she doesn't really get a key moment there or anything, and I mean, what the plot with, girl counselor whose name I've already forgotten, but
Gloriosa.
Which, okay, yeah. Fun fact, did you know that Gloriosa Rose is actually the scientific name for Black-Eyed Susan?
I did not know that.
What?
What's a Black-Eyed Susan?
It's like a daisy, but it's got a black, but instead it has yellow petals and a black
center.
Mm-hmm. Center.
Yeah, if you'll excuse me, I need to get going. Before I do, I have one final thought to share, and that is that at the end of Friendship Games, I felt like the story of the Equestria Girls universe was complete. It felt like Sunset had come full circle in her character development. It felt like a good place to wrap up the story, and I would have been happy if they had just ended the series there. So in order to continue it, I think they needed to do something to show that there's still room for this universe and these characters to grow, and I just didn't really get that from this movie.
Okay.
That is a good way to put it, yeah.
Now go on to sleep, child.
I have to go wash dishes and do other things before I can sleep, but I will talk to you guys later. Goodbye.
Goodbye. Your Prince Joe sucks.
Aren't you cool?
Anyway, second.
Yeah.
Final thoughts.
All right. Yeah, Gloria's plot, I felt like it could have gone somewhere. Like, I felt like I could have been made to care about, how badly she wants to keep this camp and just what she's been going through. But, I mean, you know, compared to the other movies, I care about Twilight trying to totally, like, find her footing and when she's totally has no idea where she is and she's up against this schemer who is just... while in her territory and such like that. I do care about these dazzlings trying to take over this school and turning everyone against each other. I even care about the school feeling like it's humiliated by this rival every year and really wanting to change that. In some ways, I relate to that even more, actually. I do not care very much about this camp we were just introduced to and Filthy Rich doing the most generic evil villain plot ever. Because I have been presented with just about no reason why I should. I mean, this camper, we learn late in the game, really wants to keep it because, I mean...
Well, what I'd have to say is that Filthy Rich is actually, you know, he's kind of depicted in a negative light. He gave her another month. I mean, that's pretty lenient.
I mean... Yeah, you know, it's like if they show us like what this camp means to everyone and like something like, I mean, I felt like I could have been made to care about it. I really didn't. It felt like a save the MacGuffin plot, and so yeah, just
no blame there. I get you there.
That didn't do much for me. So I mean, I don't know. It felt kind of scattered. It felt like that just bringing up the magic again with, that it felt like they were just kind of trying to make it match the pony world more so they could, just basically go through with the next step in the, making this a marketable franchise, making this the human version of the ponies, whereas... Like I said, I think the strength of the Equestria Girls more than anything was how it was sort of its own thing. It did have sort of its own flavor, and
I just don't know. I mean,
I think the songs are probably a perfect microcosm of what I'm talking about. I mean, they were perfectly pleasant and perfectly forgettable. Like, you'll be humming nothing all the way out of the theater if this wasn't theaters. Like, I mean, like, yeah, people,
ouch.
I don't know, I mean, people really fight me when I say that the first movie had the best songs, but I mean, having not seen that movie in a couple years, I still remember what most all of them were. I mean,
this is our big night,
that was probably one of the weaker songs in the movie. I still remember that one, I still remember the cafeteria song and the end credits song that was really pleasant. And I think the only one that was maybe kind of forgettable lyrically was the one where they're all cleaning up the auditorium. But even that, I remember.
Wait a minute, what about
that? We've got school spirit. I mean, like, that perfectly pleasant. And I mean, I think that it was used to enhance the scene it was in. Like, I remember getting kind of a really good feeling that Twilight is kind of spreading this positive vibe around. And So yeah, even that one, I would argue, has the edge over most of the songs in this movie, and which that's not a good sign. But so yeah, just I guess like I'd put this as tied with the first one for last place, maybe not even, but I don't know. Like, it wasn't unpleasant or anything like that. It felt like, it wasn't much to get that invested in.
Understandable. Yeah. No, I can see that.
Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I guess the one thing I did kind of like about the everyone getting these powers is, if you think about it, you know, even though it does rob them of some of their uniqueness in this franchise, there's also now a new angle there, like them being secretly superheroes, whereas the main six, everybody knows what powers they have, and it's not really that unique. Where the gang being superheroes in this world, that is kind of special. Anyway, pretty much all I got. I mean, I felt like if I'd just finished watching the movie, I would have, been able to say it all in one go a little better. I'm already kind of losing the sense of it.
I'm just tired.
Yeah.
I'm just tired. I have a headache.
Yeah. I will say, like, early on, I mean, I'm saying that, you know, I felt like it could have worked because it did, to some extent, hook me early on. Like, I mean, I did kind of appreciate the good old summer camp vibe we got from it and kind of the first song, although I also don't remember any lines in that. But, so, yeah, that's pretty much all I've got. Just, like, not, this might be the franchise starting to fizzle out and just fade off into, like, pleasantly bland.
If any of the other episodes are anything like this one, I kind of just hope that happens.
Movies.
Yeah, if any of the other movies are like this one, then yeah, I'm kind of with you.
All right. Yeah. So, anyway, so that's pretty much all I've got. Anyone else have any last final thoughts to add?
Sons of Shimmer is great. Copy Twilight is terrible. Otherwise, no.
This was a nice episode, in my opinion. It's probably the second best.
It's a movie.
The movie?
Just
pretend you did that on purpose.
See? Everybody else got me doing it.
But. Nobody else?
No, not really.
No.
Would anyone like to shout out anyone in the franchise?
I'd like to give a shout out to something, but it's not in the franchise.
Yeah, or does it work? In a fandom that you think people would be interested in checking out.
Well, it's not necessary. Well, I guess I should save this for what I'm doing currently. Never mind.
Yeah, just go for it.
There's dual cartoonists.
I was just going to say Civ 6 is going to be out at the end of October, and I highly recommend you guys get it. It looks really good. It's a turn-based RTS. So.
Nice.
RTS?
Real-time strategy game, basically.
Boop.
Future Evil Overlord of all things boops. Okay. Anybody else? Shoutouts.
Rebel Taxi just came out with a review on Danny Phantom.
Yeah, I saw that. I saw that. Yeah, I need to watch that.
Like, I really want to. I'm really curious about that second half he was talking about at the end. Or not the second, the third season at the end of the review.
Huh. Interesting. Interesting. Sorry, we don't have much to say to that.
I definitely have something. I found an animation someone was reacting to, and when I looked at it, apparently it was a cover that Ellie Monte took a part in. It's a song by the name of Fishy Love.
Oh my god, I love that song!
Yes, and it got an animation for it.
I saw it. It was so cute.
It's so just cute. So perfect. It was like...
It was so cute.
Wait, what is this?
A Fishy Love.
It's Fishy Love.
It's a song that was made for like the Undertale ship of Alphys and Undyne.
Oh, okay. Mm. Huh. Well, actually, yeah.
It's so good. It's so good.
Yeah, like seriously, like I would be afraid to admit it, but it's like if Alphys were to have any voice, I would certainly want it to be Ellie now.
Or Undyne.
That kind of reminds me of this other thing I saw recently. It's a video. It's a comedy video. I couldn't stop laughing from it. It was called Come Be PC. It's like this under the sea sort of like iteration. It's so hilarious. Oh my gosh. You have to watch it.
Sounds like it just writes itself.
Yeah.
Lastly, even though this is like seconds, like I'm just gonna have to say this. Remember when I mentioned about JoJo's Bizarre Adventure Part 4, easily a few weeks back?
Mm-hmm.
They came out with their third opening, which is probably gonna be the last one. It's everything that encompasses the entire Part 4, and I just am enthralled by its existence. Like, it's something that fills me on the inside visually, audially, and even the hints and the clues. It's just like, you can't be serious when I say this. It's literally like the most perfect opening for JoJo's Bizarre Adventure. Great Days by One Music.
I don't really have much else to say. Mm-hmm. Kind of all out of stuff to say.
How about you, Cadet? Anybody to shout out?
No.
Not this time?
Yeah.
Mm-mm.
Okay. Well, in that case, signing out. This is your Critic First, Fan Second, Second Opinion.
This is Past Analysis, a.k.a. Bash Analysis. Peace out.
I'm Cadet Redshirt.
This is Van York.
Oh.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Sorry. I heard a silence, so it was just kind of like,
Yeah, that's why I started to.
Cadet Sun Crimson.
I'm Cadet Redshirt. Thank you for watching.
I'm Crimson Glow, your future evil overlord of all things pony and otherwise in this world, and...
My name is Unova Brony. Always a pleasure to entertain all for the sake of happiness.
Well, I'm glad he's happy.
Oh, my.
Oh, her.